Okay, joining me from the Pet Professional Guild, all the way from Australia, I'm going to be speaking to Debra Milliken. Good morning, Debra. How are you?
I'm well, thank you. But unfortunately, it's not as sunny here as it was last time I spoke with you. So you may have it over us this week.
I don't think we have. It's been raining all night and it is miserable out there. Well, miserable is a bit of an... what's the word? Miserable's a bit too much. That's the word I was looking for. Thank you very much. So
that's a pleasure. Well, in which case, we do have better weather than you, and that's true for me.
Oh, God. I'm going to stop calling you. You do realise that, don't you?
Okay. All right.
So, Debra, tell us, what are we going to be talking about today?
Well, what I'd really like to talk about is how people decide what method they're going to use to train their dog.
Okay. And how can people make the right decisions?
Well, just think about it. When you choose to get a puppy, I think you choose to get a puppy as a companion. And I'm talking about a pet dog. I'm not talking about a working dog or a dog that's going to be used for guard training or anything. I'm talking about just your ordinary family pet dog. And when you get that little cute bundle of fluff at 8 weeks of age or thereabouts, I don't think that hurting that puppy is anywhere in your mind. I think it's one of those things that you stop and you think, I've got this little bundle of fluff and I'm going to love it and I want to love it and I want the dog to love us. And then you think, oh, well, yeah, we do need some training. Then we think, well, what's around? I don't know anything about training. What am I going to do? I need to find a trainer. I would like people to keep in the back of their minds that if you can train a killer whale to jump out of a swimming pool and pee into a pot to have his urine tested without punishment, why would you punish a dog?
I love that analogy.
It doesn't make sense.
That is a fantastic analogy. I've always said you never see a dolphin trainer with a choke chain on. It wouldn't work. So, yeah, that's brilliant.
Right.
Very, very true. So what else can people bear in mind?
Well, I think you need to remember that the reason that people use aversives in training was actually based on a false premise. There was a guy called Schenkel back in 1934 who started watching wolves in a wolf pack that was in a zoo in Austria. Now, you can imagine zoo conditions in 1934. They wouldn't have been too crash hot. And his observations of this pack of wolves, which weren't a natural pack, was actually a combination of various wolves from all over the place, and incidentally dingoes, jackals and foxes, not just wolves. And from Schenkel's observations, yes, there was what we call dominance. There was a dominant dog or wolf in the pack. Unfortunately, because it was not a real pack, that was a false premise. What happened then, many years later, David Misch, who has studied wolves in the wild for over 40 years, has said, look, this is rubbish. A wolf pack is a family group. Now, if we think about a family group as a mum and a dad and a son and a daughter, and generally the son and the daughter, let's say they're teenagers, they're living at home, and the son is a fireman. The kids have to live within the rules of the house, just like our dogs do, okay? But you know what? If there's a fire in the house, are you going to listen to Dad or are you going to listen to the fireman? You're going to listen to the fireman. And that's the way dogs should work in our house. If we teach our dogs to learn to use their nose and we tell them to go find the keys when we lose our keys, we're listening to the fireman. So what we need to do is think about how dogs learn. And they learn in exactly the same way as we do. They learn with basic learning theory. And that means that sometimes they learn by association, and sometimes it means that they learn that their behaviour has consequences. Now, a dog who's trained positively will offer you lots of behaviour that you can mould and that you can shape. And if that behaviour is being given to you, you're interacting and forming a beautiful bond with your dog. If you punish an animal, then he's not going to offer you behaviour, good or bad. He's just going to shut down, and you're not going to have a relationship with your dog. We have to remember that dogs, and this is not one of my sayings, and I'm sorry, I can't remember whose it is, but dogs are not volunteers in our lives. They're drafted. And we're the ones who label behaviour good and bad. So it's up to us to make sure that we guide the dog and basically act, and this is a Kathy Sadeo saying, that we act as the interpreter for our dog within the life that he needs to lead. And he needs to live in a human world, and that's really hard for him. So if you imagine learning a new job at work, and every time you got it wrong, somebody smacked you on the head and yelled at you, as opposed to when you got something right, he gave you 50 euros, it's a no-brainer.
I'll have the 50 euros, yeah. Training.
Absolutely. And so to me, there is no reason to punish. All we need to do is to guide. Sure, we have to set rules. People say, oh, well, that positive stuff, it's a free-for-all for the dog and he just gets fat. Well, that's not true. Not if it's done properly and positively. It's done, let's face it, dog has to eat three times a day as a puppy, doesn't he? He may as well work for his dinner rather than feeding him out of a bowl. That's just a wasted training opportunity. So we can incorporate positive training into our lives. I used to train aversively. I spent 20 years of my life training aversively, unfortunately, and almost every day I apologise to those dogs that I trained that way. My dogs now say, what do you want me to do, Mum? What's next? I never got that behaviour from my other dogs, ever. It's just one of those things. Think about how you would like to be taught a job and then translate it to that gorgeous little bundle of fluff that you have.
Okay, so you're talking about guiding the dog not to make mistakes. Now, let's say someone out there has just got themselves a puppy and they've gone out for a little while. When they come back, the puppy's peed all over the carpet. Surely punishment needs to be used now.
No, because puppy's not going to remember what he's being punished for. Dogs can read our body language so beautifully, and you walk in and you see pee all over the carpet. You don't have to say a word, and suddenly your dog looks guilty. He's not looking guilty. He's just read that your body language is not happy, and because you're not happy, he's going, uh-oh, what's wrong this time? No, what you have to do is you don't leave the dog having run of the house when you go out. You confine the dog to a space where he can either go outside and go to the toilet, and puppies can use doggy doors really quite easily, or you put newspaper down or puppy pads, or some people even go to the extent of buying those artificial grass toilets for their dogs. But you seclude the dog to a place where he's allowed to urinate or defecate whilst you're out. Giving the dog the run of the house whilst you're away, or even two or three rooms, is crazy. We have to manage those behaviours until such time as we can actually teach the dog the right thing to do. I think one of the things that's important is that management is greatly under-recognised. Manage your behaviour until such time as you've got on top of it.
Okay, so you're talking about confining the dog so he doesn't make a mistake in the first place, and then reinforcing
that's
the stuff
right.
that we do like.
That's exactly right.
There
but you know
go.
What? The hard thing is, that puts the onus back on us.
Yeah.
It makes us responsible. When you train aversively, it's so easy to blame the dog. Stupid dog, dumb dog, bad dog. And it doesn't put any responsibility onto us. And guess what? We're supposedly the greater being. We're supposed to have more intelligence. And as such, I think we should be responsible for ensuring the guidance of our dogs.
Yeah, I completely agree. It's all about guiding the dog, making sure that they're setting them up to succeed instead of setting them up to fail.
Absolutely. But again, that puts the onus back on you, the dog guardian. And that a lot of people don't want to be bothered with that. But that's what it's about. That's what it's about as far as building the bond with the dog. And believe it or not, by putting in that little bit of extra work now, particularly with a puppy, it'll make the rest. You know, if you put 12 months of good hard work into your puppy, you've got the next 10 or 15 years of a fantastic dog. If you don't, then you're going to be struggling with that dog forever.
That's very true. And it's always nicer. A dog that wants to do something will always do it better than a dog that is made to do it, is one of the things that I like to say. I hope you
agree. Absolutely. Couldn't agree with you more.
Good stuff. Debra, thank you so much again for another fantastic little training tip. And if anyone out there and they want to find out some more information about you, where can they do that?
Positivelydogs.com.
Fantastic. Thank you. Do you have a Facebook page before you go?
Canine Behavioural School Facebook page. If you Google Canine Behavioural School Facebook, I'm sure that will come up, but I'm not really very technical.
Neither am I. Don't worry. Thanks for joining us, Debra, and we'll speak to you again very soon. There you go, guys. So, Debra Millikan, all the way from Australia, giving you a few tips and tricks about reinforcing the good behaviour in your dogs instead of just taking it for granted, which is very easy to do. But if you have got a puppy and you are struggling with toilet training, then please don't hesitate to go to my website, www.inthedoghousedtc.com, and you will find a video there that will help you house train your brand new best friend absolutely free.